Good morning, Krakow. Let's try that one more time. Good morning, Krakow. Excellent. I'm really, really thrilled to be here this morning. Really thrilled. I haven't been to Poland before. One of the joys about speaking is I get to travel to various cities, wonderful cities with a rich cultural heritage, and spend all the time in conference centers and hotels. And it's appalling, actually. I'm a terrible tourist because I always want to get back home to my family because I don't spend nearly enough time with them, which means I always miss out on the riches that various European cities and things have to offer. But it is really thrilling to be here, partly because the vodka here is really good. It's also a joy that I'll be presenting this session, which Raf requested, because it was in some ways a turning point in my speaking. When I first presented this back in November 2009, this was actually the first time I had taken this style of presentation of just drawing some slides randomly and very, very badly. I'm a terrible artist. And since then, I've sort of changed exactly how I do it. So I went back to rediscover these slides and found that various of them had been quite badly scanned. So I went and sort of digitally remastered these slides, which involved drawing them again. And it's interesting to look back at what I said back in Stack Overflow Dev Days 2009 and see how a bit more experience has just reinforced what I said back then, and I've got even more war stories to tell you now. So I am Jon Skeet. I work for Google. I have to say, I'm sort of contractually obliged to say, I am not speaking on behalf of Google. So anything that I say that's particularly stupid, and there may be many things that are particularly stupid, please don't think that all Google employees share that view whatsoever. So that's me, and this is Tony the Pony. Tony is unfortunately not a very good developer. It's sad. I think he has motivation, but not so much on the ability side. So you know, we'll see whether he pays any attention today, and maybe he'll learn a thing or two. But okay, Tony wants me to make something very clear. He's not just a developer. He's also a magician on the side. He's been thinking of giving up software engineering to do a bit of magic at children's parties and things. There's just one problem. He only knows how to do one magic trick. He's just a one-trick pony. I did ask before the session how good people's English was likely to be, would you get really bad puns? So most of the time, if I'm saying anything about Tony the Pony, assume it's a really bad pun, okay? And just laugh anyway, even if you don't get it. It'll make me feel better. So I want to talk today about the mess that we're in and why we tend to feel like this guy. We want to get on with doing interesting things in our development, right? We want to be making the best way of widgetizing a frubjugator or whatever it is. Or maybe, you know, picking which JavaScript framework we're going to use tomorrow, because it's bound to be a different one to the one that we used yesterday. So why is it we spend so much of our time looking like this? And back in 2009, I had spotted a trend on Stack Overflow. And since then, it's been confirmed and confirmed and confirmed to me that fundamentally, the world is screwed up. And in this talk, I'm going to blame three sets of people for this. I'm going to blame users, or more generally, humanity throughout the ages. Excuse me, Tony, would you hold that? Thank you. He's got very strong teeth. It's great. So users have this interesting tendency to think that everything will be simple. And in fact, I've worked with some project managers who get involved in discussions where it's, you know, we're treating something that's really quite tricky and complex and whatever, and they say, guys, this is simple. It's like, if you think it's simple, you just don't understand the problem. So users have this idea of it should work intuitively without understanding that everyone's intuition is different. And it's not just users now. In fact, I think most of our problems are due to history, because people have evolved in different places, and we have a world that spins around the sun, and all kinds of things like that that have screwed us up. And I'll give examples of how that's happened. So we have complex systems because the world is complex, and then architects get involved. And they think, I've been to an agile conference, I shall build this in an agile way, and I've been to some object-oriented conference, so I shall have an abstract singleton bean factory tupelizer. And, do you know, strokey beard. Do you know, I think I can make the world's most beautiful framework that no one will understand. The trouble is, they don't understand the complex problem that they're modeling either. You know, the users from the previous slide have messed things up so much that even the strokey beards can't understand what they're trying to do. And then there's us. And the problem is that we don't understand either the real world system or the strokey beard framework or the actual problem that we're trying to understand. And even if we do understand all of those three things, chances are when we try to implement it, we'll mess it up anyway. So we're to blame. And these days, as an open source developer, I'm sort of somewhat in the architect camp as well. So most of us are at least responsible for two of these things, if not all three. So you should all feel very bad about yourselves. Let's talk about numbers to start with. So I've got three basic data types to talk about, or even types of data types that we've messed up. You really don't need to get to very complex things before it gets ludicrous. So you think the things that computers ought to be good at are numbers, okay? It's hard not to get numbers right when you're a developer, yeah, when you're a computer, because that's all they do is numbers. And yeah, we've got other things that come from numbers, but we should really be able to get numbers, right? Anyone ever had any problems with numbers? Yeah? Gosh, well, if you really haven't, then maybe I should just sit down. That would be fine. Or we could all go for coffee early. But there is a vast number of questions on Stack Overflow and problems I've seen in other places because people don't understand numbers. And I blame evolution. We have 10 fingers and thumbs. And that's a bit of a problem because it means that we count in tens. We tend to count in tens, and computers don't. So I think this would be much better. Eight is not ideal. 16 would be better in a way. You know, half a byte's worth of bits. Or maybe we should just count on our fingers and not include our thumbs. If we'd done that to start with and been in base 8 forever, then we'd get a much better sense of binary. Life would be significantly simpler. But we are where we are, so I'd like to give you a little problem. Okay, are you ready for this, Tony? Very enthusiastic. Okay, here's a bit of C sharp. Sorry, no, this is the Java version. Here's some Java. Tony doesn't know Java. Tony, letting me down. Okay, here's the C sharp version then. There we go. Oh, he's much happier about this. It took me really quite a while to find the color here that most closely matched the eclipse highlighting for double. But anyway, this is closer to Visual Studio. Okay, so we've got some C sharp here. So Tony, your first question of the session, what is the value of D? Okay. Tony thinks the value of D is 0.3. We say, no. Sorry, Tony. For some bizarre reason, Tony had the idea that because he had something saying D equals 0.3, that the value of D would be 0.3. It's just, what are you thinking, Tony? This is crazy talk. Clearly, the value of D is this. And for anyone who's saying, oh, floating point, it's just approximation. No, the value of D is exactly this. The approximation only comes converting the 0.3 to this. After that, this is an exact number. So we've got this problem because we use double. And one of my beefs with C#, I love the language in general, but I wonder how fewer problems we would have if we just defaulted to use decimal instead of double. And you know, I'm not saying that we shouldn't have double. Look at these two values. We've got, I'm sorry I didn't get the symbol for zlotys. Or euros would have been okay, I guess, but you know, stick with British pounds. These two numbers are both 5.5, but they are fundamentally different. And it's this understanding the difference that many developers, who knows what proportion, but a lot, don't understand the difference between these two numbers. The first one is a discrete number. It's an artificial number. It's man-made. It's appropriate to represent it in decimal because it's kind of inherently decimal. We can easily get £5.51, £5.52, and those will be exact numbers. 5.5 kilograms, well, nothing's going to be exactly 5.5 kilograms anyway. We're already approximating. It's more of a continuous value. It's a natural value. So there, it's appropriate to use double. Just because you know, we do get some benefits of efficiency, it would be fine if you want to use decimal for that. You get slightly smaller range and all kinds of things. But you do need to understand that these are two different kinds of numbers. And that's where a lot of us fall down. So numbers are relatively hard, and people do get into this, the number of questions that say, why is multiplication broken in Java? Why is addition broken in C#? Why don't I understand the data types I'm using? You'd be shocked. I've been coming to the conclusion for several years that if people understood the data types they were using and really thought about them, many, many, many questions just wouldn't appear. I'm not going to deal with all of the situations where that happens here, but understanding your data is vitally important. Okay, so if we can't do numbers, let's do text. That should be simple, right? Yeah? In fact, when I first wrote this out, I missed out ipsum from lorem ipsum. And seeing as lorem ipsum are the only two words that anyone actually knows from lorem ipsum, it's a real, real mistake to mess those up. But yeah, we should be able to do text. It's always discrete, right? You know, there's no idea of continuous characters. Well, sort of. We get into situations like this, where we've got some people on one island who have started with Latin characters, and then someone's got Katakana characters. I've no idea what these mean. If anyone understands these and they're really rude, then I apologize. They're just ones that I randomly picked from Unicode. So this is, again, a problem that users have brought us. Fundamentally, we've grown up in different places, we've developed different systems of writing. And that is a problem. It's a real problem that is, I was going to say, is not going away. It may do over time. Sadly, the diversity of languages is shrinking. At the same time as the diversity of computer languages seems to explode, which is kind of interesting in itself. But maybe in 100 years' time, everyone will only speak Chinese. Or maybe everyone will only speak English, or some other language that doesn't exist yet. But this is a solved problem as well, right? Because we've got Unicode! Whee! Well, yeah, yes and no. We've got Unicode, but unfortunately, people don't understand it. Architects have had good ideas about things and haven't always been quite as forward-thinking as they might have been. 65,000 characters will be enough for everyone? Well, yeah, not so much. So let's introduce bigger things beyond the basic multilingual plane. But we can at least represent most of the characters, and that should be easy. So, Tony, I'm going to give you a task, okay? I want you to write some code to reverse the characters in a string. Tony, what are you doing? What are you doing? Tony? Oh, this is his one magic trick. Tony's one magic trick is to write code in a PowerPoint presentation on the next slide. How's that going to go down at children's parties, Tony? Okay, I think we really need to up Tony's ability for development, because magician, just not going to happen. Okay, so you've got some code ready, yeah? And it's in C#. Okay. So, let's have a look, Tony. So we've got some text. We're creating a character array, reversing the array, and then creating a new string. You've managed to avoid repeated string concatenation. That's good. He's been learning. So what do we think of this code? Oh, Tony. It's a good attempt, but it is sadly broken. Let's look at just a couple of reasons why it's broken. And yeah, I can't really blame you. It looks good, Tony. It does. It looks good. It's just that Unicode's a bit more complicated than this. So let's take Les Miserables, one of my favorite musicals. We can have a representation where every letter is its own character. Or we can have this representation where the backslash U0301 is a combining character which adds an accent. Now, this is one of the slides that I redid since London. Partly because I think the original slide has a few lines on it, but mostly because the first slide was wrong. My original slide had the backslash U0301 before the E. This wasn't just due to laziness, well, maybe a little bit of laziness, but I had written a little Windows Forms application. I couldn't remember whether combining characters went before or after the letter that they were combining. So I thought, I'll write a little Windows Form app, put that string in, show it on a dialog box, everything will be fine. And sure enough, the version with it before the E showed up as Les Miserables. Great, except WinForms has a bug in it. It renders text wrongly. I only found this out later on when I tried to do the same thing in WPF, which does it correctly. And it turns out that if you start a new WinForms project in Visual Studio, which I hadn't, I just use a little text editor and compile and run, it has something about use compatible text rendering. And if you set that to an appropriate value, it then does things properly instead of doing it in the backwards compatible but broken way. So this is genuinely Les Miserables. Unfortunately, when we reverse it with Tony's code, we end up with the accent on the R. Because by the time you've reversed U0301, you end up with U0301, then the E, and that combining character ends up on the R, which gets rendered perfectly properly. You know, it's just a combining character. I have no idea whether there are any languages where having an acute accent on an R makes any sense whatsoever, but it renders just perfectly. But we don't need to go to combining characters to have problems. Take the Windows line break. And this is, again, a problem entirely of our own making. As far as I'm aware, the reason we've got carriage return line feed is because of printers, where things were too slow, or where you had two different things, one to say, go back to the start of the line, and another to say, and go to the next line. And for some bizarre reason, this ended up in terminals and in Windows in particular. So we've got different line endings for different systems, which is a pain completely unnecessarily. But now think about Tony's code. We end up with /n/r, which could do different things depending on whether you're running on Notepad or showing it on a Linux box or whatever, but it's probably going to be wrong. Whatever you want, it's going to be wrong. And then we've got surrogate pairs. So have any of you tried to write code in C# or Java? So, you know, systems which are based on UTF-16, anyone who tells you a string in Java is a sequence of Unicode characters, that's what I used to say. It's a sequence of UTF-16 code units, which sounds a lot less sexy. Do you know what? I think the idea that a sequence of Unicode characters is sexy is kind of worrying in itself, but okay. been coding too long. So sequence of UTF-16 code units. If you want to represent a character outside the basic multilingual plane, you have two characters. And both Java and .NET have ways that you can manipulate strings according to real Unicode characters instead of UTF-16 code units. And they're a real pain to use. Any of you tried to use them? No. No one does. No one does. If you say, I want a text box that must be at most 10 characters, you don't mean you want it to be at most 10 characters. You want at most 10 UTF-16 code units. And then if you've got people who try to type their name in that's 10 characters long, but those characters are outside the basic multilingual plane, sorry, you can only have 5. Feels a little bit unfair. No one's going to have a name outside the basic multilingual plane, but you take my point. Let me give you another example. This isn't Tony code. So, Tony, I apologize if I've been embarrassing you at all. It's not just you. This was, something like this at least, was in my code when I was working for a tiny startup called Peramon, which has disappeared without a trace. I was there right from beginning to end. We lasted about 5 or 6 years, which is a bizarre length of time for a startup. You usually either burn quickly or get successful. We sort of held on there for quite a while and then died. Fantastic learning experience, partly because I spent a load of time on newsgroups. It was great. So this was some code that I got. Where's the bug? This worked fine in all our testing. It was checking some header value or other. Anyone see what's wrong? Uppercase should be invariant. So, or in the Java version, is you use two uppercase that takes a locale and you specify locale ENUS. Where is this going to fail? Right. So the gentleman said there is a few situations where the lowercase I doesn't get uppercased into an uppercase I. When I said, where is this a problem? I mean specifically where. Yes, I heard it from someone. Turkey. Have you all heard of the Turkey test? Run your code in Turkey. Because it's only Turkey, as far as I'm aware, it's only Turkey that has this problem, and it's only Turkey, only the I in Turkey that changes. You know, we've got a whole API just for one character in one locale. I'm coming up with my own Turkey test, by the way, to do with dates and times. It is to do with text, though, as well, because you all know not to include values in your SQL, right? You don't do select star from foo where id equals plus x. You all know not to do that, right? You might think it's okay if they're dates, because dates can't include SQL injection attacks, right? Can you imagine a SQL injection attack with a date value? I can. If I can control your computer and change your culture, I can change the default date format to be, quote, drop table passwords. And it's very easy. I've proved this. You can create your own culture info in .NET that has exactly that. I'm going to write a blog post about it and run your code in that culture, with that as the default culture, and see what happens. Just another reason. I mean, there are so many reasons to use parameterized SQL, but that's just another one. So this caused a real support call, and after this I went through our entire code base and changed every time that we used two uppercase to specify that I wanted it to be in English. But that isn't always what you want to do, of course, because if you're trying to uppercase it to present to a user, you actually do want to provide the user's culture. If someone is in Turkey and they're just trying to see their name in uppercase, they want to see the I with a dot on or whatever it is. I think there's an argument for having two different types of strings, one being machine-readable strings that are actually just, this is a convenient way of passing data around, and they should be parsable and all kinds of things. And maybe substring is okay on that because, you know, we take part of the data. And then we've got human-readable strings, which are basically a black box. We're never going to understand them without a lot of work. And things like substring and uppercasing and whatever, you need to handle really carefully. And I think if we had two different types for those so that we wouldn't get confused between the two, well, it could produce some interesting results anyway. So that's another real-life example. Here's an example that I saw on a newsgroup. This was some C-sharp code before we had contains, so this was quite a while ago, to replace, you probably can't terribly easily see, this is meant to be two spaces. That's two spaces, and that's one space. For people over here, two spaces, one space. Okay? So what do you think this code does? Removes duplicate spaces. Yes. Does it work? Can anyone predict in what way it won't work? People who haven't just read my blog post of this talk from back in 2009. The types of spaces. So... Yep. Ah, yes, it will. We've got a loop here. So the first time through, it will replace the first two with one. And then, so it does that. It wouldn't cope with different kinds of spaces in terms of if you have a non-breaking space, it wouldn't collapse those. But do you think it will at least finish? Seems reasonable? No. Consider this string. Unicode 200C is a zero width something. Index of will see the two spaces here and kind of ignore the strange character in the middle. So it will pick up that there is a double space near the start of the string. Replace won't. So the call to replace will just return the same string, including the middle bit. So we end up with an infinite loop. And the fact that I saw this on a newsgroup post suggests that at least someone really ran into this as a problem. So, have I convinced you that numbers are too hard and text is too hard? Yeah? So surely we can get dates and times right. Okay, back in... This is another bit of history. Back in 2009, I had been working on the ActiveSync implementation for Google. So if any of you had iPhones and synced up to your Google account and were syncing your calendar down, if there are any problems, you can blame me. And this was a real eye-opener for me. So I already had some interest in dates and times. I'd heard about Joda time before, but hadn't really used it much. But wow, it's amazing just how complicated dates and times are. So let's make it a little bit simpler. Let's remove relativity from the equation. Because I don't think, well, do any of you have business requirements which mean that you have to take into account relativity? Anyone raise your hand? Nope. Okay, so we're good. The next is leap seconds, which I gather I was reading on Slashdot just yesterday. There's another conference where they're deciding, should we at least recommend that leap seconds vanish from UTC? Do any of you understand leap seconds? A few, yeah. I don't. I really don't, and I've tried a couple of times. I understand the principles of leap seconds, that you know we're not spinning at a uniform rate, so it's trying to keep our clocks in line with the sun being directly overhead at 12 o'clock, or our position relative to stars and things. But it's just too hard, guys. Aside from anything else, we can't predict it. It's really strange. Can you imagine if you couldn't schedule things because you don't know what the time's going to be in 10 minutes? It makes no sense. So let's discard that to start with. In fact, it may be a little bit hard to discard because things like Java util date explicitly documents this may or may not include leap seconds. I'm just going to discount it completely. So, okay, Tony. Right. Your next question. What is the time here? Okay. Right. Okay. Tony thinks this is 3:05 on September the 20th, 2013. Okay. So far, so good, Tony. Whee. A round of applause for Tony. Okay, right so far. So what's the difference between now? So, yep, okay, it's 10 to 10, right? Tony thinks this is the time in 5.25 hours. Who thinks he's right? Nope. Why not? No time zone. So that's one thing. We don't know which time zone is in. Yeah, it's no, you don't know. Mustn't get aggressive with the guests. Okay, there's no time zone specified. And actually, this is 3:05 in the morning. Who'd have thought? This actually, you know, as it happens, you're wrong, I'm afraid. This really is in this time zone, which at 3:05 in the morning, my phone wasn't this morning. I changed my watch, I changed my laptop, I forgot to change my phone, which was very unfortunate as my alarm was on my phone. So I woke up an hour later than I should have done. And was convinced for a little while that it was the clock in the bedroom that was wrong. I should really have thought, no, they've probably got the time zone right. But in fact, actually, this isn't even today. Because this is September the 20th, 2013, in the Julian calendar. Just for fun. At least that's fairly close. It could be in the Hijri calendar, in which case we're hundreds of years out. So there's loads of ambiguity here. We don't know even the time of day. We don't know which calendar system we're using. And you're right, we don't know which time zone we're using. Ah, time zones. Can anyone spot anything interesting about this slide of time zone abbreviations? Anything? CST is 3 times, yes. I haven't repeated any time zones. This one, no, sorry, it's this one, is Central Standard Time in America. And this one is Central Standard Time in Australia. And this one is Central Summer Time in Australia. I think it takes a special kind of weirdness to have the same abbreviation for different time zone bits. I mean, they're not even time zones. This is one of the things that irks me. I didn't actually finish my story about the history. Since giving the presentation in 2009, when I was ranting about this and Java util date being rubbish and .NET's date time API being awful as well, I felt so guilty about it that 2 months later, I started the Nodatime project, which is a better date and time API for .NET, which took about just over 2 years to come up with version 1, and we're hoping to release 1.2 when I can get around to it. And you know, I've learned a lot, and in particular, I've learned a lot about some really crazy time zones that go on and some crazy calendar systems. Any of you from Sweden? Right. Did you know just how crazy your forebears were? So, how many days does February have? Give me, you know, the possible options. 28, 29, or 30 in Sweden. Only in 1712. So, Do you vaguely understand Julian calendars and Gregorian calendars? Okay, the Julian calendar has leap years every 4 years like clockwork. The Gregorian calendar has a leap year every 4 years, except every 100 years, but it is every 400 years. Okay? That's a really good formula. It's easy enough that I can remember it. It's hard enough that it would be reasonable to put as a first interview question, always good. You know, because if they can't get that, they're probably not going to get any further. Well, it's sort of, it's a real world fizz buzz. So you know, the accuracy of the reason for doing that complicated rule in the Gregorian calendar, it's a bit like the difference between saying pi is roughly 3 and pi is roughly 22 divided by 7. Okay, the second is a much better approximation. The point of leap years is to mean that it's roughly the 365.25 whatever it is, days that it takes to go around the sun, so that we don't end up with December in the middle of summer after a few thousand years. So the Gregorian calendar is a much better representation of that. And everyone had been using Julian calendars for a long time. And then different countries, if you try to do history on a computer and try to tie up dates, it's a complete nightmare. Because different countries adopted the Gregorian calendar at different times. And that's actually where the timestamp part of a type 2 grid, I think it is, that I think is based in 1752. You know, who'd have thought the Catholic Church would affect the form of grids? That sounds kind of crazy, but no, the timestamps are based from when the Gregorian calendar was adopted, either in Rome or maybe in the UK and the US, whichever it is. Most countries decided to do this in one lump. So they had to skip a load of days. And I think if you use the right year, then the Unix calendar, you know, Cal, if you show September, it will skip from whatever it is, September 3rd to September 14th. Can't remember the details, but it skips. Sweden thought, no, we shall do this differently. We shall sort of smear this change over many years. We'll just not have leap years for a long time until we've caught up with where we should be on the Gregorian calendar. Okay? So it's like having a time zone where instead of going from standard time to summertime in one go, you would go, well, I'll have 10 minutes on this week, 10 minutes that week, 10 minutes the next week. Can you imagine organizing meetings like that? Crazy. And then the Seven Years' War happened. So they decided to do this early 1700s. And then I think it was in 1704, they remembered, we're not having a leap year. So they were then one day behind or one day ahead. I get very confused between behind and ahead when it comes to time zones and things. For someone really interested in time, it's kind of embarrassing. They thought, we won't have our leap year. That's fine. And then the war started, and in 1708, they forgot. You couldn't make this up. You really couldn't. They forgot that they weren't meant to have a leap year, so they had a leap year. And then the King of Sweden or whoever said, right, oh, enough. Okay, this is crazy. Let's just go back to the Julian calendar. So we've got to make up for the fact that we're one leap year behind. So in 1712, they had a double leap year. They could have done it by having an extra leap year in 1710 or something, but they thought, no, we'll have a double leap year. So the 30th of February, 1712, only in Sweden. And that's not even time zone. That's calendar craziness. There's time zone craziness. I've mentioned CST. Does anyone know when the Unix epoch is? Oh, come on. 1st of January, 1970, when? UTC. Yes. GMT wasn't in effect at the start of 1970. We were in BST in London, in Greenwich, was observing BST. Anyone know what BST stands for? Usually, yes. Usually it does stand for British Summertime. But no, between, I think it's 1968 and 1971, we had a little experiment. We would be in British Standard Time, which was UTC plus one, and didn't observe daylight saving time. So just like the Australians with CST twice, we've got British Summertime and British Standard Time, both being BST. But it means that at the time of the Unix epoch, the time at Greenwich was 1 o'clock. And we say that the Unix epoch was 1970 UTC. UTC didn't exist in 1970. It was introduced in 1972. So even the Unix epoch is a bit messed up. You've then got interesting time zones like Brazil. So again, you know, I showed a mistake, a bug earlier on with text. I had a bug in my calendar sync thing where if someone had a date and I wanted to have a reminder or something, I would say, I will use midnight of that day as when I send the reminder or when I consider it. You know, if you're going to show it on a graph or something, you want midnight of the day. Does that seem reasonable? Yeah, so all day event goes from midnight to midnight. Unless you're in Brazil. Because in Brazil, one day of the year, midnight doesn't exist. Or at least, it depends on how you define midnight. But yeah, you would have thought midnight would be easy to define, but even Wikipedia effectively has two definitions. It says it's the transition between one day and the next. That's a good definition. By that definition, Brazil does have midnight. It then shows representations being 12 o'clock. And Brazil doesn't have that, because it goes 11:59:59, 1 o'clock, because they have their summertime transition, which is in the winter because of Southern Hemisphere kind of things. Their clocks go forward at midnight. So again, I got a load of exceptions in my logs and had to change to use Joda Time's start of day. You know, wherever you are in this time zone at the start of the day. And finally, time zone-wise, there's Samoa. Anyone know anything interesting about Samoa, time zone-wise? They changed recently. Yes, they skipped December the 29th, 2011, because they went from UTC minus 10 to UTC plus 14. And you know, for reasonable reasons, okay, I don't dispute the reasons, but it would have been much more sensible if they'd done it at midday to midday than midnight to midnight, because it meant that if you have a date on December the 29th, 2011, it's not happening. They did it for the reasonable reasons of trading partners and also for tourism. Can anyone think why it might be important for tourism?
First New Year.
Yeah. People will go to a hotel specifically to be the first people in the world to celebrate New Year. Whereas in the old Samoan time zone, they would be the last people in the world to celebrate New Year. So I'm proposing something different. This is the clock, the calendar system that I'm proposing. It isn't affected by time zones. It doesn't need batteries. You don't need NTP. This is coffee time. It's the permanent answer to the question, is it time for another coffee? And I think it's all we need. So, hopefully I've persuaded you that the world has messed us around. Time zones in particular just mess our heads completely. Most of us don't need to deal with any calendar other than the Gregorian calendar. But if you have users who ever need to see their local times, you need to be aware of time zones. And many, many date and time APIs hide them. They think, no, that's too complicated for people. And it is complex, but you need to know about it. Our architects have messed us up because of exactly that kind of thing. They thought, I shall have the world in this neat bucket, and the poor developers don't need to concern themselves with details like daylight saving time. I've really taken this to heart in the last few years developing Noda Time. I'm not saying I've got in any way a perfect API, but I have gone out of my way to make developers think. People say, a perfect API is one where developers don't have to think. I think it's the exact opposite. I want you to think about the problems that you really need to think about, where I can't take the decision for you. I will put that decision front and center, explain to you what that decision is, and then make it really easy. Once you've made that decision, I try to make it easy for you to implement that in code so that it will be clear what that decision is. But many, many APIs, not just date and time, look at float and double. Arguably, if we had grown up in a situation where computers were fast enough doing decimal arithmetic, the world would be a simpler place. And certainly around text, Unicode is just too complicated. Even if it's the best solution there is, it's still insanely complicated. You know, none of us stuck our hands up to say that we were really trying to handle text properly in our applications. Even just the number of characters, let alone right-to-left text. I've never tried to write any UIs. I'm not a UI guy. But mixing right-to-left and left-to-right and where the cursor should be if you hit the right arrow several times, it's insane. So our architects have let us down. And we've let ourselves down because we don't understand time zones and text and all the different rules because they're complicated. And we don't understand the tools that have been provided for us. And then we're too incompetent. Even when we do understand them, we make silly mistakes. There are ways that we can mitigate this. I alluded to this a little bit in date and time stuff. So reduce scope where you can. The whole Yagni, you ain't going to need it, can be incredibly valuable. If you are only going to launch your product in one country, then don't worry about internationalization. You've got to be really, really certain that that's the case, because it will be very expensive if that assumption turns out to be wrong. But if you can make that assumption, go for it. Just this morning, I had a mail from someone on the Nodatime project saying he's thinking of porting it to JavaScript. Porting the API part to JavaScript, I don't know exactly how the underpinnings will work. And I haven't replied yet, but I'm going to suggest that unless there's a compelling reason for supporting calendar systems other than the Gregorian calendar, just don't bother. 99% at least of web applications don't need to deal with the Julian calendar and the Hijri calendar, etc. So just don't bother. It will make everything easier, not just in terms of implementation, but in what end users, or sorry, what developers need to understand. So reduce your scope when you can. Try to not ignore those problems, those corner cases. Be aware of them. Work out just how far in the complexity you need to go. And always make sure you understand a little bit more than you implement. If you're right at the boundaries of your understanding in your code, then chances are there will be something that you've missed, some little corner that you haven't delved into. So try to make sure that you've scoped it so narrowly that you're pretty confident in your understanding of these things. And try to use the right tools for the job. So if you're using Java, then do use Jodatime instead of the terrible, terrible Java util date, Java util calendar APIs. If you're using .NET, then use Nodatime. Please come and talk to me about Nodatime. I would like to think it will make your chronological code much simpler to understand, because you can actually say, this is a date, and this is the time of day, and this is a date and time in a time zone. These are all different types, whereas in .NET, you've got date time and time span. It's not enough. So use the right tools for the job, and if you're careful, you can succeed. Any questions? Silence. Any questions not about what I've just been speaking about? Here, we've got a couple of minutes. No? Okay. Oh, yes. Right, so the question is, in developing Nodatime, did I come across any situations where the problem is just too complex to represent in a good abstraction, and we've just got to live with something that we know is a bit sucky? Is that a reasonable restatement? Yeah. Well, there are some things where, you know, we're explicitly saying we don't do leap seconds, we don't do relativity, and that's relatively easy, no pun intended. We have recently come to the conclusion that some of our design decisions were flawed around the real boundaries. So we support years up to about 26,000 AD and about 26,000 BC. And we've got overflow checking on so that it doesn't wrap round, but you get into problems near the boundaries of time where there are operations that you would like to be able to succeed but just don't. So we could have a period of thousands of years and minus thousands of weeks. So if you sum them together, it should be something within range. But I just say, no, if it's out of range in any aspect of it, then it's out of range. And we've still got problems around that, around the borders, that I want to fix in another release to say, okay, you can only go within certain limits that are actually slightly narrower than they currently are, because otherwise you get crazy stuff. We have a bug that says near the end of time, we claim that the month number is 260 or something. I haven't even gone into the maths of why that's happening. But there have definitely been situations like that. There have been other situations on a purely technical basis where we've struggled for a while to find a good solution. And often someone else has provided a solution. One example is time zone providers. I wanted to make the code as testable as I could and not have the idea of a static time zone provider that was the current default provider. I've tried to steer clear of contextual defaults as far as possible. And I found that really, really hard. But then someone else came up with a patch for it that actually made everything very nice and clear. So if you want to use TZDB, which most people would, you just explicitly say datetimeproviders.tzdb, and then you can use that, or you can use the BCL ones for Windows time zones. So there have definitely been a few in different gradations of that kind of thing. And there are almost certainly others that I'm not aware of yet. Any other questions? I'm definitely running out of time, and you can feel free to grab me over coffee as well. Yes? Aha. So referring to the 30th of February in Sweden, how do I discover this kind of issue? Sometimes through Stack Overflow. So my most popular answer on Stack Overflow, answers on Stack Overflow are meant to be upvoted if they're useful, right? How many people do you think are actually dealing with dates and times in 1929 in China? Probably not 3,200 people who've upvoted my answer on why, if you happen to take, so you take two local times that look like they're a minute apart, but they're actually 6 minutes and 21 seconds apart or something, because that's when China went from being very location-based. So back in the late 19th century, early 20th century, a lot of places used times that were time zone offsets that were strictly based on location. So in fact, in France, I think it's in France, there would be different clocks inside and outside stations. Because outside the station, you would be in the really local time for the town that you're in, whereas inside, everything was on railway time, which was the same throughout the country. So there are lots of time zone transitions that are a few minutes and a few seconds here and there. And actually, that retrospectively changed in a later version of TZDB, which broke some unit tests that I had. So I have some unit tests for Stack Overflow questions within Noda time. You know, here are examples of things that people have got wrong on Stack Overflow, and here's how Noda time would solve them and make them obvious. And then a different version of TZDB made the transition happen 1 second earlier or later. So my unit test failed. So a lot through that. It's the kind of thing that if you read up on any topics, people like, you know, I like disseminating this kind of information, and other people who have it like saying about it. And other things of like the Brazil time zone, I found out because I got 5,000 exceptions in a log. Some of these are real, very difficult issues. Any other questions? Yep. Sorry, how do I handle calendars with 13 months? I give you an answer of 13 if you ask for the month number. So if you convert from one calendar to another, doesn't matter whether there are 13 months or even converting between the Julian and Gregorian calendars, you're actually converting a date on the planet, as it were. So you say, well, what would someone observing the Hijri calendar call this? And what would someone observing the Gregorian calendar call the same day? And you do that rather than try to say, well, the year, month, and day must match up, because they just don't. So that's another great example of where you really want to think about what's the meaning of this data. The meaning isn't a year number and a month number and a day number. The meaning is a date on the Earth. So if you want to convert between calendars, you want to say, what did that date look like in a different calendar? That's a very interesting example. Okay, I think I'm really out of time. Come grab me over coffee, but thank you very much, and thank you from Tony.